Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Queen of Distraction, How Women with ADHD Can Conquer Chaos, Find Focus, and Get More Done, by Terry Matlen, MSW. Narrated by Randye, Kaye. Foreword. For the past 20 years, I have had the great pleasure of knowing Terry Matlen professionally and personally as her mentor and colleague. I have watched her become a respected and influential leader in the field of adults with ADHD and one of the handful of experts in the country who understands the special challenges and experiences of women with ADHD. Terry has accomplished this through her pioneering online work, writing, working with the media, memberships on boards of national ADHD organizations, and through her coaching and presentations. On a personal level, Terry openly and generously shares her own experiences with ADHD with her audiences, readers, and clients. This personal wisdom and professional knowledge informs all of her work and allows her to convey the nuances and subtleties of the experience of women with ADHD. Far from giving formulaic advice, Terry's new book combines her thirst for research with her understanding of the inner, felt experience of this group of women. I met Terry when I was writing my book, Women with Attention Deficit Disorder, which was originally published in 1995, new edition 2005. Women with this unique brain chemistry and life experience reported that, in reading the book, they were able to see their most secret experiences described in detail for the first time. It unleashed a wave of excitement in these readers, as well as professional interest about this group of typically undiagnosed women who didn't fit the stereotype of hyperactive boys that prevailed at the time. As a psychotherapist, I focused on what happens to women who aren't able to meet gender role expectations due to their challenges. I explored the resulting shame and guilt that keeps them from moving toward their strengths, their dreams, and a fulfilling life. This is the experience, perspective, and lens through which I read what is written for and about women with ADHD. Often, books, articles, or presentations for these women focus only on the symptoms that can be observed from the outside, or on strategies that aren't connected to or don't take into account the internal experiences that are so intimately intertwined with their challenges. As a result, women seeking help are often set up for frustration and failure. Terry's new book, The Queen of Distraction, adds the missing pieces by connecting her excellent strategies to the inner experience of the reader, while recognizing that employing these strategies is much more complex than simply buying a fancy new planner or taking medication. Terry provides detailed descriptions and solutions for areas of high impact for women with ADHD, such as shopping, dressing, and managing clutter. Despite a clear recognition of these issues, her writing has no hint of subtle blaming, shaming, or stereotyping, but is instead infused with respect for the struggle. She is able to communicate the important truth that women with ADHD must not define themselves by their challenges. Terry brings all this to life through her humor, memorable stories of real women with ADHD, and a warm, inviting tone that helps women feel understood and accepted. Her personal honesty is extremely therapeutic. Her openness gives women who have long lived with ADHD in secret permission to accept themselves in the same way Terry has learned to do. The reader comes to feel the sense of belonging and understanding that is often missing from her life. The Queen of Distraction is comprehensive but extremely well organized in a format that is easy for women with ADHD to read, absorb, and identify with. It goes beyond simple solutions, definitions, diagnoses, and stereotypes to present an authentic, accurate view with a fresh, original approach. Terry's metaphor of triage in various areas of challenge, such as dealing with clutter, is especially compelling and intriguing, and a useful way to prioritize and take needed action. Whether you are newly diagnosed or a woman who has been diagnosed for years, I highly recommend you read this book all the way through. After that, keep it close by to refer to when you need a great personal coach like Terry right there beside you. Equally important, though, open it whenever you feel overwhelmed or vulnerable, when you need a reminder, as we all do from time to time, that your struggles are real, that they originate in your brain, that they are not reflections of your character or your personal failings, and that there are countless other women who share this journey with you. Sari Solden, MS, LMFT. Acknowledgements. This book would not have seen the light of day had it not been for Melissa Valentine and the team at New Harbinger Publications. Thank you for finding me and putting your faith in me. Many thanks go to my writing coach and editor, Jeannie Ballou of Edit Prose, who stuck with me through thick and thin and helped make my words shine brightly. I couldn't have done this without your expert help and gentle, kind support. I'd also like to thank Sari Solden, whose groundbreaking work in the field of women with ADHD inspired me to choose this path of helping others with ADHD. I will always be grateful for your generous support and encouragement. I'd also like to thank all of you who have reached out to me over the years, sharing your stories, your heartbreaks, and your successes. I've learned so much from you. You are such an inspiration. Do not ever lose hope. To my dear mother, Helen Wackler, who told me on a daily basis while writing this book how proud she was of me, even at my age, I was lucky to have been raised by a mother who embraced creative thinking and expression and who told me I could succeed in whatever path I chose, regardless of the grades on my report cards. And to my stepfather, Norman Wackler, for the stability he gave our family and the wisdom that he shared throughout the years. To my unique and wonderful daughters, Kate and Mackenzie, thank you for being my shining stars. There are no words to express my love for you. You make my life a complete joy. And to my dearest husband, Jerry, my rock, best friend, and fishing buddy, thank you for your patience, support, and belief in me, and for keeping me afloat this past year while my head was in this book. Thank you for your unwavering love, your ability to make me laugh hysterically even after all these years, and the hundreds of carry-out dinners that thankfully found their way to the table. Introduction. I have been in your shoes. I lived with undiagnosed ADHD for over 40 years. When my kids were little, figuring out what to make for dinner each night and pulling it off felt like an Olympian challenge. I faced piles of laundry because I struggled to decipher the seemingly simple steps of sorting, washing, drying, and putting it away. It was typical to wake up to a wet heap of smelly clothes in the washer because I had forgotten to load the dryer the night before. I avoided talking on the phone because if I couldn't see the speaker's mouth, I couldn't focus on the words, and my mind would drift 100 miles away. My house was cluttered, bills were paid late, and over I asked myself, how can I earn 2 academic degrees but not be able to file 10 papers? What is wrong with me? Discovering I had ADHD and getting help for it changed my life in ways I never dreamed possible. As I gained confidence in myself through learning more about ADHD and how it affected me, I began to baby step my way into a new, exciting life that included this thing called ADHD. I learned that my ADHD didn't define me, but explained many of my quirks and difficulties. Once I saw how vastly different and better my life became, I wanted to offer hope to other women with ADHD, women like you who might be living in shame, self-loathing, or pure frustration. Since the mid-1990s, I have been working with adults with ADHD in a variety of capacities. I volunteered for many years at CHAD, Children and Adults with Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, and ADDA, Attention Deficit Disorder Association. I led support groups online and launched http://addconsults.com, where I've been able to meet and help thousands of men and women online. My journey led me to writing my first book, Survival Tips for Women with ADHD. Who would have thought that the quiet, sensitive soul who was happiest locked up in a cozy room reading a book would end up presenting talks to hundreds of people around the country on the topic of women with ADHD? My hope is that this book will continue my voyage toward helping other women with ADHD who, like me, got so very stuck with the symptoms of ADHD, drowning in clutter, being late, burning dinner, feeling constantly overwhelmed. I'm living proof that you can move on despite your ADHD and find happiness and success. No, it's not a walk in the park. It takes lots of hard work and perseverance, but it can be done. I hope this book will help you start your own journey and that you will find that your ADHD is only a small part of who you are. The information and tips that follow will help you get started on your way to becoming the person you were meant to be. After all, she's been there all along. A note to readers. Throughout the book, I will be using masculine pronouns for partners. This is for convenience only. I do not intend to exclude readers with same-sex partners. TM. Chapter 1. What the heck is ADHD anyway? Best friends since nursery school, Liz and Alex like to refer to themselves as sisters, though they couldn't have been more different. Liz was tall, dark, thin, and brooding, whereas Alex was short, athletic, cheerful, and constantly in motion. They are now in their early 30s. Over the years, Alex juggled multiple low-paying jobs while performing at local theater and musical festivals on the weekends. She got fired from job after job due to poor performance, not getting projects done on time, being late almost daily, or not getting along with coworkers. Liz, on the other hand, felt constantly overwhelmed by teaching and her two highly active children. One fall weekend, Liz and Alex drove to a cottage in Canada, deliriously happy to escape their troubles, even if just for a few days. Upon arrival, Liz parked herself in a hammock near the beach with a novel and promptly fell asleep. When she awoke, Alex was nowhere to be found. Liz's head filled with worst-case scenarios. Maybe she got swept up in the waves. Could there be bears? Maybe she got lost. She tried calling Alex's cell, but Alex didn't answer. Hours later, after Liz had worked herself into a tizzy, Alex came barreling through the screen door, grinning from ear to ear, and launched into how she'd seen a fox, snapping turtles, lizards, and more on her nature adventure. When Liz glared at her and told her how sick with fear she'd been, Alex stopped dead in her tracks. Once again, she'd failed a friend with her impulsive ways. They sat down, had a heart-to-heart, and put it all behind them. Well, Alex did. But Liz spent the next hour ruminating over her friend's apparent lack of courtesy and worried how their weekend together was going to pan out. Do either of these women's behaviors sound familiar? Alex is full of fun and adventure, constantly on the move, slamming through life like a hurricane, leaving crumpled papers and relationships in her path. Liz feels everything with intensity and worries over details. She is often lost in her rich, dreamy internal world, escaping to it frequently while life goes whizzing by her. She is easily distracted, leaving a trail of unfinished projects behind her that give clues as to her latest interests and activities. Maybe you, like both Alex and Liz, have adult ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. In this chapter, we will review our current understanding of ADHD, the different subtypes, and the various terms that have been used for it in the past. The nuts and bolts of ADHD. Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, ADHD, is a neurobiological disorder. In other words, a disorder in the biology of the nervous system, characterized by impairment of executive functions and self-regulation. This results in inattention, hyperactivity, impulsivity, or a combination of the two. In order for a diagnosis of ADHD to be made, the disorder has to have started in childhood and cause impairment for the individual in one or more environments, work, home, and so on. Let's look more closely at the results of impairments in executive functioning. Who among us hasn't had trouble composing that first sentence for a paper or an important letter? It's not easy, but many of us do eventually get past the mental impasse and summon the complex planning and organizational skill necessary to write term papers, run work projects, plan a kitchen renovation, or separate dark-colored laundry from light. Executive function, EF, is an imposing name for a group of essential mental tasks that help us achieve those goals. Planning, strategizing, organizing, goal setting, paying attention to important details. Executive functioning, the control panel of your brain, basically involves figuring out how to get from step A to step B to step C. It is like the track that keeps the train on course as it stops, starts, and turns, getting you to your destination. In addition to poor executive functioning, ADHD involves poor self-regulation. According to internationally recognized ADHD expert Dr. Russell Barkley, 2013, adults with ADHD typically become easily distracted by stimuli, find it hard to stop behaviors and activities that are engaging and of interest to them, impulsively make decisions, don't follow directions carefully when starting a project, often don't follow through on promises or commitments, have trouble doing things in proper sequence, speed while driving, find it hard to enjoy quiet, leisure activities. These symptoms exemplify how impairing ADHD can be to a woman because they encompass just about all the facets of her life. Though executive functioning and self-regulation sound like terminology straight out of a college textbook, suffice it to say that these seemingly absent-minded behaviors are, in fact, brain-based, and there is a perfectly rational explanation for why you do the things you do. Introducing the ADHD subtype trio. ADHD, commonly called ADD or attention deficit disorder, is an umbrella term that encompasses the three subtypes of ADHD. Though the vast majority of cases of ADHD are genetic, in some cases, one can acquire ADHD through brain injury, illness, or prenatal exposure to toxic substances. It is important to note that ADHD is not caused by poor parenting, excessive TV, or one's diet. Though neither Alex nor Liz has officially been diagnosed with ADHD, they exhibit classic symptoms. We'll explore their symptoms a bit more below after a discussion of the three subtypes of ADHD. Hyperactive, impulsive, inattentive, combined. The most common is the combined subtype, which, as the name suggests, combines both hyperactive, impulsive, and inattentive symptoms. Let's go through each subtype and look at some of the common symptoms seen in each. Hyperactive impulsive subtype. Hyperactive impulsive subtype behavior is characterized by incessant mental, verbal, or physical activity that is often carried out without consideration of consequences. Typically, these behaviors are less overt in adults than they are during childhood. Answer these questions and see if you exhibit any of the behaviors or tendencies they describe. Do you have a hard time finishing a book? Do you fidget during meetings, tapping your fingers or swinging your feet? Do you blurt out things and interrupt others, or have you been told that you simply talk too much? Do you find it hard to relax? Do you enjoy high stimulation activities even if they might be dangerous? Do you overeat, overspend, over everything? Do you leave a trail of stuff everywhere? Do you sometimes feel out of step socially? Though all adults have some of these problems, an adult with ADHD will have them more frequently and find them to be troublesome in life. If you have many of these problems and they interfere with your life, it may be time to get an evaluation for ADHD. Inattentive subtype. The woman with the inattentive subtype of ADHD often lives a quieter, more internal life than her hyperactive, impulsive countertype. She is prone to daydreaming, feels a chronic sense of being overwhelmed, and worries and ruminates. Inattentive women may be physically sluggish or prefer quiet activities, but many have hyperactive brains that crave stimulation as well. It's important to understand that both subtypes have symptoms in common. See if you answer yes to a majority of the questions below that describe common symptoms seen in adults with the inattentive subtype of ADHD. Do you have trouble paying attention to detail? Do you make careless mistakes? Do you tend to be shy? Do you feel sluggish much of the time? Do you struggle with hypersensitivities? Do you have trouble staying on task unless it's an activity in which you have keen interest? Do you have a poor memory? Do you see people's lips moving but don't pay attention to what they are saying? Do you often have difficulties following or understanding instructions? Do you avoid tasks that involve a lot of effort? Are you easily distracted? Do you forget where you've put things? We all misplace our keys or fade out of a boring conversation at times. If, however, you have many of these symptoms and they impair your life to some degree, it's time to be evaluated for possible inattentive ADHD. Combined subtype. A woman with a combined subtype of ADHD has symptoms of both inattention and hyperactivity impulsivity, but not enough inattentive or hyperactivity impulsivity symptoms to warrant a diagnosis of either of those subtypes. She may be constantly on the run, but also have a dreamy quality to her personality, getting lost in her thoughts and missing the finer details in her work and life in general. It's important to note that there is a paucity of studies attempting to describe the subtypes of ADHD in adults, and symptoms of all three subtypes may overlap. But knowing what subtype you might have can help you and your therapeutic team. For example, women with inattentive ADHD might be more prone to depression than their hyperactive, impulsive counterparts, so practitioners might be extra careful in looking for symptoms of depression that also need to be addressed. Looking back at the Liz and Alex vignette, we can see that Liz has inattentive ADHD. She's dreamy, in her own world at times, distractible and introverted, whereas Alex exemplifies the combined subtype, as she has symptoms of hyperactivity impulsivity, dashing out into the lake, yet also has inattentive traits, not paying attention to Liz's feelings and needs. If you're a bit confused by this terminology soup, take heart, you're not alone. Even the experts can't agree on everything. Is ADHD a disease, a condition, or a new cable channel? ADHD has gone through so many different definitions that, after you've heard them all, you may ask, will the real definition please stand up? These definitions have ranged from minimal brain damage to hyperkinetic reaction of childhood or adolescence. At the turn of the 20th century, doctors such as British pediatrician Sir George Frederick Still, 1902, described children with ADHD-like symptoms as having a moral defect. Later, these children were thought to have suffered brain damage. In the 1960s, there began a shift toward thinking of this disorder as a behavioral syndrome with a biological basis. In the late 1970s, clinicians began to focus on the possibility that not just children but also adults could have ADHD. And in the 1980s, that focus shifted from just hyperactivity to deficits in attention, Lang et al., 2010. It is often now referred to as attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, though many simplify the terminology by calling it attention deficit disorder, ADD. Either is acceptable. Just as experts have grappled with the terminology, so have they also tried to discern if ADHD is a neurobiological brain-based disorder, a disease, or a condition. A study published in the Journal of Neuropsychiatry and Clinical Neurosciences, Courvoisier et al., 2004, states that there are actual chemical differences between the ADHD brain and the non-ADHD brain. So whether it's a disorder, disease, or condition is a matter of semantics, but it's important to know that every person with ADHD is an individual with strengths and challenges. No two people with ADHD share the same exact symptoms. In an effort to make friends with ADHD, some describe it as a gift, but there haven't been any solid studies to prove that, and professional opinions are mixed. Dr. Russell Barkley, 2010, rejects the notion that ADHD is a gift or that it predisposes to anything positive in human life. ADHD expert Dr. Edward Ned Halliwell suggests in the biography page on his website that, rather than a disorder, ADHD is a gift that is hard to unwrap, and he leans towards seeing ADHD as a condition that can be tamed so that one's true abilities, creativity, and gifts can shine through. One ability or gift that often shines through is thinking outside the box. Many of us who work in the ADHD field notice that a good number of our clients do that naturally. That's not to say, however, that your ability to think outside the box or your ADHD is always an advantage. Often it gets in the way of expressing your creativity. In the case of Alex, her ADHD got in the way of finding success in her music career. Her dream of forming her own band and writing original songs vanished. She just couldn't get along with others, nor could she finish what she started whenever she attempted to pen a new melody. As researchers try to figure out what exactly ADHD is, it's clear that attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is actually a misnomer because there isn't a deficit of attention, but rather an inability to control it. You may not have the patience to file paperwork for more than 10 minutes, but you can browse, read hyperfocus, on the internet for 2 hours because it holds your interest. Some people even humorously call it attention surplus disorder because of how quickly you can change your attention from one thing to another, depending on what interests or distracts you. Attention can be scattered, diffuse, or laser-like, but rarely anything in between. My own personal and professional leanings on what ADHD is tend to lie somewhere between Dr. Barkley's and Dr. Halliwell's definitions. ADHD can be a disabling disorder, but with a proper treatment, many people can uncover their strengths and soar. The key is getting the appropriate help. If you have not already been diagnosed, perhaps you're curious enough now to pursue an evaluation. If that's the case, you might wonder what to do first. My advice is to start by seeing your primary care physician or other healthcare provider and get a complete physical workup. You want to make sure that your symptoms can't be attributed to a physical cause, such as an under- or overactive thyroid, allergies, or a sleep disorder. If you've been medically cleared, then it's time to pursue an ADHD evaluation. Since adult ADHD, unfortunately, is still not well understood by many clinicians, it's to your advantage to find someone, psychiatrist, psychologist, neurologist, or other mental health professional, with expertise in adult ADHD. Too many adults, especially women, are misdiagnosed as having depression because many of those symptoms overlap with ADHD. Or you might have depression in addition to your ADHD because your life has been filled with chaos, underperformance, and low self-esteem from repeated failures in certain areas of your life. Since ADHD rarely travels alone, there is a good chance you may have a coexisting condition, such as depression, anxiety, or addictive behaviors, that also needs to be addressed. That's why you want to find a professional who can sort these things out. Treatment for adult ADHD typically includes medication, when recommended, counseling, education, support, for example, support groups, and ADHD coaching. ADHD coaching involves working on pragmatic life skills that are impaired by your ADHD. An ADHD coach works with you on such areas as time management, organizing, and procrastination, and helps you break old habits and learn new, healthier, and more effective strategies in these areas. You should get information and resources for all of these options from your clinician. If you're not sure you have ADHD and would like to learn more about getting a qualified diagnosis or exploring typical treatment options, you can find in-depth information about both diagnosis and treatment on my website at http://addconsults.com. By getting diagnosed, being treated, and reading books like this one, you will begin to understand why you've struggled with many areas of your life. For example, one of the most frequent complaints I hear from women with ADHD is their struggle with clutter. But this isn't a character flaw, personality disorder, or weakness. It's simply a result of how your brain is wired. So let's jump right in and find out how to tame the clutter beast. Chapter 2. My life is buried under one of these piles. Alex is cussing loudly. Annoyance escalates into rage as she stomps around her house searching for the letter to appear in court for a speeding ticket. Teeth clenched, she admonishes herself for not having put it in her new to-do folder. She calls the court and finds out that she missed her appointment and is now in danger of losing her license. Clutter 1, Alex 0, again. What exactly is clutter? For some, it's three pieces of mail sitting on the kitchen counter. For those of us with ADHD, it's 3 feet of paper someplace where it does not belong. Sadly, as a woman with ADHD, you might be defining your self-worth by how much clutter you have lying about your home or workspace or even in your car. It becomes your obsession, your nemesis, your daily reminder that your life is out of control, that you haven't mastered the art of maintaining your living area and workspace like everyone else has by the time they are 16. You've probably heard comments such as these your entire life. Why can't she put her stuff away? Doesn't she care about how it affects the rest of us? Why is she so lazy? What a pig. And you have most likely internalized these painful, derogatory, negative remarks over the years until they have slaughtered your self-esteem, making you wonder, what is wrong with me? Clutter and chronic disorganization combine to create a virtual hellhole for women with ADHD, a seemingly endless abyss that threatens to suck them down on a daily basis. The compromised executive functioning of the ADHD brain makes all things weigh in as equally important, thereby making sorting, selecting, and tossing a real challenge. Though seemingly mundane tasks are extremely challenging for the woman with ADHD, if she is partnered or married with children, she is quite often expected, as the home manager, to manage not only her own mass of papers and personal belongings, but also those of her children and spouse. This chapter offers insights into the underlying brain-based issues that contribute to clutter and disorganization, the resulting emotional issues that often go hand in hand with that clutter, and pragmatic, get-it-done solutions to help you manage the clutter beast and keep it in its cage. What does my brain have to do with my messy house? Messiness, clutter, disorganization. These are not character flaws. They are symptoms of how your ADHD brain functions. The lack of executive functioning directly contributes to why it is so hard for you to stop the overflow of papers, toys, kitchen utensils, and clothing as they cascade from your kitchen table, desk, and closet onto the floor. Executive function impairment is universally seen in adults with ADHD. It's no mystery that your space is taken over by stuff, because your brain has a hard time prioritizing what to do first, how to do it best, and when to do it. Your brain circuitry finds it difficult to prioritize. Do I pay the bill first or send in the wedding RSVP? Stick with boring tasks. Paperwork is so boring, I think I'll play a video game instead. or sort? Do I file it under car or stick it in bills paid? Do you also have trouble starting or stopping a task? If so, you are not alone. Starting requires prioritizing and decision-making. Stopping is hard because once you get into a task, you may tend to hyperfocus and have time distortion. What seems like 5 minutes is actually 30 or vice versa, as well as difficulty transitioning from one activity to another. And on it goes. Think about the symptoms typically seen in ADHD that we talked about in Chapter 1. Impulsivity, inattention, procrastination, difficulty transitioning, and forgetfulness. Let's take a closer look at each of these now. Impulsivity. You see something in the store and purchase it, not realizing at the time that you don't need it, don't have the space for it, or worse, already have two of them. The outcome? The new item lands on a table and stays there for weeks, months, or longer until you find the time to make a decision as to what to do with it. By then, you probably decide that you'd like to return it, but find that either you've lost the receipt or it's too late to take it back. Inattention. As with impulsivity, you see something you like, shoes, for example, and purchase them, not realizing they don't remotely match anything in your closet. Or at a garage sale, you snag a great bargain, the perfect dresser for storing all the things you seem to collect but have no room for. But you've forgotten that there is zero space in your house to put the dresser. Or you're so wrapped up in watching the morning show every Wednesday that you don't think to take out the garbage, and you now have 3 weeks' worth of trash stinking up your garage. Procrastination. Clutter can also be a result of procrastination. It's right there, facing you eyeball to eyeball, reminding you of just how difficult it is to take care of your stuff. If you can't figure out where to put your things or find it too difficult or too boring to set up a system for your stuff and simply put off doing anything about it, there it lies, underfoot, sometimes forever. Years ago, when I needed to set up my home office, I hired a professional organizer who taught me something so fundamental that I was shocked that I had never understood the concept before. Everything you own needs a home. Once there's a home for everything, clutter becomes less of a problem. Clutter happens when you don't know what to do with things, or when you have duplicates of something you've forgotten you already own. By creating a home for each of your things, when you have an item in your hand that needs to be put away, you now have a place where it belongs. Difficulty transitioning. But here is another ADHD dilemma. Being unable to transition from a pleasurable activity to an...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.